do you do when you are not sure? That is the topic of my sermon today. You look for God's direction when you cannot find it. Last year when President Kennedy was assassinated, who among us did not experience the most profound disorientation? Despair. What now? Which way? What do I tell my kids? What do I tell myself? It was a time of people sitting together, bound together by a common feeling of hopelessness. But think of that. Your bond with your fellow beings was your despair. It was a public experience shared by the community. It was awful. We were in it together. How much worse is it then for the lone man, the lone woman who was stricken by a private calamity? No one knows I'm sick. No one knows I've lost my last true friend. No one knows I've done something wrong. Imagine the isolation. You see the world is through a window. On one side of the glass, happy, untroubled people. And on the other side, you. Something's happened, and you have to carry it, and it is incommunicable. For those so afflicted, only God knows their pain, their secret, the secret of their alienating sorrow. And when this person, as they must, cries out to God, "Help me!" What if no answer comes? Silence. I want to tell you a story. A cargo ship sank, and all her crew was drowned. Only one sailor survived. He made a raft with some spars, and being of nautical discipline, he set his eyes to the heavens and read the stars, setting out a course for home. Exhausted, he fell asleep. Clouds rolled in and blanketed the sky. The next 20 nights, as he floated the vast ocean, he could no longer see the stars. He thought he was still on course, but there was no way to be certain. As he wasted away with thirst, fever, and starvation, he began to have doubts. Had he set his course right? Was he still going on towards home? Or was he horribly lost and doomed to a terrible death? The message in the constellations, had he imagined them because of his desperate circumstances? Or had he seen truth once, and now had to hold on to it without further reassurance? That was his dilemma, on a voyage without apparent end. There are those of you in church today that know exactly the crisis of faith I described to you. I want to say to you, doubt can be a bond, as powerful and sustaining as certain. When you are lost, you are not alone. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, amen.
Intentionally given himself a nosebleed.
Exactly.
No!
You are a very innocent person, Sister J. James. William London is a fidgety boy. He would do anything to escape his chair. He would set his foot on fire for half a day out of school.
But why?
He has a restless mind.
But that's good.
No, it's not. His father's a policeman, and the last thing he needs is a rowdy boy. William London is headed for trouble. Puberty has got a hold of him, and he will be imagining all the wrong things. And I strongly suspect he won't graduate high school. But that's out of our jurisdiction. We simply have to get him through, out the door, and then he's somebody else's problem. Usually, I assign my most experienced teachers to the eighth grade, but I'm working within constraints. Are you in control of your class?
I think so.
Usually, more children are sent down to me.
Well, I try to take care of things myself.
That can be a mistake. You are answerable to me. I to the Monsignor, he to the Bishop, and so on up to the Holy Father. There is a chain of discipline. Make use of it.
Yes, sister.
How's Donald Mueller doing?
Steady.
Good. Has anyone hit him?
No.
Good. That Linda Conte girl, have you seated her away from the boys?
As far as space permits, it doesn't do much good.
Just get her through. Intact.
So should I go? Is something the matter?
No. Why is something the matter?
I don't think so.
And nothing's the matter then.
Well, thank you, sister. I just wanted to check on William London.
He had a ballpoint pen.
Excuse me, sister?
William London had a ballpoint pen. He was fiddling with it while he waited for his mother. He's not using it on assignments, I hope.
Oh, no, of course not.
I'm sorry I even allowed cartridge pens into the school. Children should really be only learning script from true fountain pens. Always the easy way out these days. What does that teach? Every easy choice today will have its consequence tomorrow. Mark my words.
Yes, sister.
Ballpoints make them press down, and when they press down, they write like monkeys.
I don't allow the ballpoint.
Good. Penmanship is dying across the country. You have some time. Sit down. We might as well have a talk. I've been meaning to talk to you. I observed your lesson at the beginning of the semester on the New Deal. Not bad, but I caution you. Do not idolized Franklin Delano Roosevelt. He was a good president, but he did attempt to pack the Supreme Court. I do not approve of making his heroes out of lay historical figures. If you want to talk about saints, do it in religion.
Yes, sister.
Also, I question your enthusiasm for history.
Oh, but I love history.
That's my point. You favor history and risk swaying the children to value it over their other subjects. I think this is an error.
I've never thought of that. I'll try to teach my other subjects with more enthusiasm.
No, give them their history without putting sugar on it. That's the point. Now, tell me about your class. How would you characterize the condition of 8B?
I don't know where to begin. What do you want to know?
Well, let's begin with Stephen Inzio.
Stephen Inzio has the highest marks in the class.
Noreen Horan.
Second highest marks.
Brenda McNulty.
Third highest.
You see, I'm making a point. I know that Stephen Inzio, Noreen Horan, and Brenda McNulty are 1, 2, and 3 in your class. School-wide, there are 48 such students, and I make it a point to know all 48 of their names. I don't say this to aggrandize myself, but to illustrate the importance of paying attention. You must pay attention as well.
Yes.
I cannot be everywhere.
Am I falling short?
These three students with the highest marks, are they the most intelligent in your class?
No, I wouldn't say they are, but they work the hardest.
Very good, that's right. That's the ethic. What good's a gift if it's left in a box? What good's a high IQ if you're staring out the window with your mouth agape? Be hard on the bright ones, Sister James. Don't be charmed by cleverness, not theirs, and not yours. I think you're a competent teacher, but perhaps not our best teacher. The best teachers do not perform. They cause their students to perform.
Do I perform?
As if on a Broadway stage.
I had no perception.
You're showing off. You like to see yourself 10 feet tall in their eyes. And another thing occurs to me, where were you before?
Mount St. Margaret's.
All girls?
Yes.
I feel I must remind you that boys are made of gravel, soot, and tar paper. Boys are a different breed.
Well, I feel I know how to handle that.
But perhaps you're wrong. And perhaps you're not working hard enough. Oh. No tears.
I thought you were satisfied.
Satisfaction is a vice. Do you have a handkerchief?
Yes.
Use it. Do you think Socrates was satisfied? Good teachers are never content. We have some 372 students in this school. It is a society which requires constant spiritual, educational, and human vigilance. I cannot afford an excessively innocent instructor in my eighth grade class. It's self-indulgent. Innocence is a form of laziness. Innocent teachers are easily duped. You must be canny, Sister James.
Yes.
When William London gets a nosebleed, be skeptical. Don't let a little blood fuddle your judgment. God gave you a brain and a heart. The heart is warm, but your wits must be cold. Liars should be frightened to lie to you. They should be uncomfortable in your presence. I doubt they are.
I don't know. I've never thought about it.
The children should think that you see right through them.
Wouldn't that be a little frightening?
Only to the ones that are up to no good.
But I want my students to feel like they can talk to me.
They're children. They can talk to each other. It's more important that they have a fierce moral guardian. You stand at the door, Sister James. You are the gatekeeper. If you are vigilant, they will not need to be.
I'm not sure what you want
and
me to do.
If things occur in your classroom which you sense require understanding, but you do not understand, come to me.
Yes, Sister.
That's why I'm here. That's why I'm the principal of this school. Now, can you stay when the specialty instructors come in?
Yes.
But you're here now while art is going on in class.
Well, I was concerned about William London.
Right. So, you have art in class.
She comes in. Mrs. Bell, yes.
Then you take them down to the basement for dance with Mrs. Shields?
On Thursdays.
Another waste of time.
Oh, but everyone loves the Christmas pageant.
I don't love it. Frankly, it offends me. Last year, the girl playing Our Lady was wearing lipstick. I was waiting in the wings for that little jade.
Then there's music.
Oh, with that strange woman with the portable piano. What's wrong with her neck?
Some kind of goiter. Coral.
Yes. Mrs. Carolyn.
That's right.
We used to have a sister teaching that. Not enough sisters. What else?
Physical education and religion.
Those, we have Father Flynn. 2 hours a week. And you stay for those?
Well, mostly. Unless I have reports to fill out.
What do you think of Father Flynn?
Oh, he's a brilliant man. What a speaker.
Yes. His sermon on Sunday was poetic.
He's actually very good, too, at teaching basketball. I was surprised. I wouldn't think the man of the cloth, the personality type for teaching basketball, but he has a way he has, very natural, dribbling and shooting.
What was his sermon about?
What?
On Sunday, what was he talking about?
Well, doubt. He was talking about doubt.
Why?
Excuse me, sister?
Well, sermons come from somewhere, don't they? Is Father Flynn in doubt? Is he concerned someone else is in doubt?
I suppose you'd have to ask him.
No. That would not be appropriate. He is my superior, and if he were troubled, he should confess it to a fellow priest or the Monsignor. We do not share intimate information with the priests.
I'm a little concerned.
About what?
The time. Art class will be over in a few minutes. I really should go up.
Have you noticed anything, Sister James?
About what?
I want you to be alert.
I don't believe I'm following this.
I'm sorry I cannot be more forthright, but I cannot create something by saying it. All I can say is that I am concerned, perhaps needlessly, about matters at St. Nicholas School.
Academically?
I wasn't invited to guessing game. I just want you to pay attention to your class.
Well, of course I'll pay more attention to my class, sister. And I'll try not to perform. And I'll try to be less innocent. I'm sorry you're disappointed in me, but please know that I try my hardest, honestly.
Look at you. You would do anything for a reassuring look. I am telling you, here and now, I want to see the starch of your character cultivated. If you look for reassurance, You can be fooled. If you forget yourself and study others, you will not be fooled. It's important. One final matter, then you really must go. Sister Veronica is going blind.
Oh, how horrible.
This is not generally known, and I don't want it known. If they find out in the rectory, she'll be gone, and I cannot afford to lose her. But now, if you see her making her way down those stone stairs into the courtyard, for the love of heaven, lightly take her hand as if in fellowship, and see that she doesn't destroy herself. All right, go.
Boys, settle down. Now, the thing about shooting from the foul line is, it's psychological. The rest of the game, you're cooperating with your teammates, or you're competing against the other team. But at the foul line, it's you against yourself. And the danger is, you start to think. And when you think, you stop breathing. Your body locks up. So you gotta remember to relax. Take a breath. Unlock your knees. This is something for you to watch, Jimmy. You stand like a parking meter. Come up with a routine of what you do. Shift your weight. Move your hips. Oh, you think that's funny, Ralph? What's funny is you never getting a foul shot. Don't worry if you look silly. They won't think you're silly if you make the basket. Come up with a routine. Focus on the routine. And you'll forget to get tensed up. Now, on another matter, I've noticed that some of you boys have dirty fingernails. I don't want to see that. Now, I'm not talking about the length of your nails, I'm talking about the cleanliness. See? Look at my nails. Yes, they're long. I like them a little long, but they're clean, and that makes it okay. This boy I grew up with, Timmy Matheson, never had clean nails. He'd stick his fingers in his nose and in his mouth. This is a true story. Learn to listen. He got spinal meningitis and died a horrible death. Sometimes it's the little things that get you. You try talking to a girl with those filthy paws, Mr. McConroy, she'll take off like she's being chased by the Red Chinese! All right. Settle down, boys. What am I going to do with you? All right, get dressed. Head on over to the rectory. We'll have some Kool-Aid and cookies. We'll have a bowl session. Go!
Good afternoon, Sister James. Mr. McGinn pruned these bushes, which was the right thing to do, but he neglected to protect them from the frost.
Have we had a frost?
When it comes, it's too late.
You know about gardening?
A little. Where's your class?
The girls are having music.
And the boys?
They're in the rectory.
With Father Flynn?
Yes, he's giving them a talk.
On what subject?
How to be a man.
Well, if sisters were allowed in the rectory, I would like to hear that talk. I don't know how to be a man, and I want to know what's involved. Have you ever given the girls a talk on how to be a woman?
No. I wouldn't be competent.
Why not?
Well, I just don't think I would. I took my vows at the beginning, before, at the beginning.
The founder of our order, the Blessed Mother Seton, was married. Had 5 kids before embarking on her vows.
I've often wondered how she managed so much in one life.
Life is perhaps longer than you think, and the dictates of the soul more numerous. I was married.
You were.
You could at least hide your astonishment.
I didn't know.
When one takes on the habit, one closes the door on secular things. He died in the war against Adolf Hitler.
Really? Excuse me, sister.
Unlike you, I'm not sure
I would feel competent
lecturing tittering girls on the subject of womanhood. I don't come in this garden very often. What is it, 40 feet across? Convent there, the rectory here. I might as well be separated by the Atlantic Ocean. I used to potter around out here all the time, but Monsignor Benedict does his reverie at quixotic times, and we're rightly discouraged from crossing paths with priests unattended. He's 79, but nevertheless.
Monsignor's very good.
Yes, but he's oblivious.
To what?
I don't think he knows who the President of the United States is. I mean him no offense, it's just that he is otherworldly in the extreme.
Is it that he's innocent, Sister Aloysius?
You have a slyness working about you, Sister James. Be careful of it. How's your class? How's Donald Mueller?
Donald Mueller is 13th in class.
I know. It's sufficient. Is he being accepted?
He has no friends.
Well, that would be a lot to ask of him after only 2 months. Has anyone hit him?
No.
Good. When they do, send them to me.
I'm not so sure anyone will.
There is a statue of St. Patrick on one side of the church altar and a statue of St. Anthony on the other. This parish serves Irish and Italian families. Someone will hit Donald Mueller.
He has a protector.
Who?
Father Flynn.
What?
Well, he's taken an interest since Donald went on the altar boys. I thought I should tell you.
I told you to come to me, but I hoped you never would.
Maybe I shouldn't have.
I knew once you did, something would be set in motion. So it's happened.
What?
I'm not telling you that. I'm not even certain what you mean.
Yes, you are. I've been trying to become more cold in my thinking, as you suggested. But I feel as if I've lost my way a little, Sister Aloysius. I had the most terrible dream last night. I want to be guided by you and responsible to the children, but I want my peace of mind. I must tell you I've been longing for the return of my peace of mind.
You may not have it. It is not your place to be complacent. That's for children. That's what we give them.
I think I'm starting to understand you a little, but it's so unsettling to look at things and people with suspicion. It feels as if I'm less close to God.
When one takes a step to address wrongdoing, one takes a step away from God, but in his service. Addressing such matters is hard and thankless work.
I've become more reserved in class. I feel separated from the children.
That's as it should be.
But I feel wrong. And about this other matter, I don't have any evidence. I'm not at all certain that anything's happened.
Can't wait for that.
But what if it's nothing?
That it's nothing. I wouldn't mind being wrong, but I doubt I am.
Then what's to be done?
I don't know.
You'll know what to do.
I don't know what to do. There are parameters which protect him and hinder me.
But he can't be safe if it's established. I doubt he could recover from the shame.
What have you seen?
I don't know.
What have you seen?
He took Donald to the rectory.
For what?
A talk.
Alone?
Yes.
When?
A week ago.
Why didn't you come to me?
I didn't think there was anything wrong with it. It had never entered my mind that there could be anything wrong.
Of all the students, Donald Mueller. I suppose it makes sense.
How does it make sense?
He's isolated. The little sheep lagging behind is the one the wolf goes after.
I don't know that anything's wrong.
Our first Negro student. You know, I thought there'd be fighting, a parent or two to deal with. I should have foreseen this possibility.
How could you imagine?
It's my job to outshine the fox in cleverness. That's my job.
But maybe it's nothing.
Then why do you look like you see the devil?
It's just the way the boy acted when he came back to class.
He said something?
No. It was his expression. He looked frightened. And one other thing. I think there was alcohol on his breath. There was alcohol on his breath.
8 years ago at St. Boniface, we had a priest who had to be stopped. But I had Monsignor Scully then, whom I could rely on here. There's no man who will help me, and men run everything. We're going to have to stop him ourselves.
Can't you just report your suspicions?
Monsignor Benedict? The man's guileless. He would just ask Father Flynn.
Well, would that be such a bad idea?
And he would believe whatever Father Flynn told him. He would think the matter settled.
Well, maybe that's all that needs to be done, if it's true. If I had done something awful and I was confronted with it, I would be so repentant.
Sister James, my dear, you must imagine a person very different from yourself. A man who would do this has already denied a great deal. If I tell Monsignor Benedict and he is satisfied with Father Flynn's reply, the matter is suppressed.
Well, then tell the bishop.
The hierarchy of the church does not permit my going to the bishop. No, once I tell the Monsignor, it's out of my hands. I'm helpless. Gonna have to get Father Flynn into my office, try to force it, and you'll have to be there.
Me? No! Why, sister, I couldn't!
I can't be closeted alone with a priest. Another sister has to be there, and it has to be you. The circle of confidence can't get any wider. Think of the boy if this gets out.
I can't do it!
Why not, you squeamish?
I'm not equipped! I would be embarrassed. I couldn't possibly be present if the topic were spoken of.
Sister James, please, do not indulge yourself in witless adolescent scruples. Believe me, I would prefer a more seasoned confederate, but you're the one who came to me.
You told me to!
Would you rather leave the boy to be exploited? And don't think that this will be the only story. If you close your eyes now, you'll be a party to all that follows after.
You're supposed to tell the Monsignor
that you saw a look in the boy's eyes, that perhaps you smelled something on his breath. Monsignor Benedict thinks the sun rises and sets on Father Flynn. You'd be branded a hysteric and transferred.
We can ask him, who, the boy, Donald Mueller.
He'll deny it.
Why?
Shame?
You can't know that.
And if he does point the finger, how do you think this will be received in the community? A black child. I'm gonna have to think this through. I'll invite Father Flynn into my office on an unrelated matter, and you will be there.
What good can I do?
Aside from the unacceptability of a priest and nun alone together, I need a witness.
To what?
He may tell the truth and then lie afterwards.
The boys are coming out of the rectory. They look happy enough.
They look smug. Like they have a secret.
There he is.
If I could, Sister James, I would choose to live in innocence. But innocence is only wisdom in a world without evil. Situations arise and we are confronted with wrongdoings and the need to act.
I have to take the boys up to class.
Well, go on then, take them. I will be talking to you. Sister Veronica tripped on it and fell on her face. I think she's fine. She doesn't look any worse, Mr. McGinn. Thank you, Mr. McGinn. Come in.
Good morning, Sister Aloysius. How are you today?
Very well, thank you. Good morning, Father Flynn.
Are we ready to begin the meeting?
We're just short, Sister James. Did you hear that wind last night?
I did. Imagine what it must have been like in frontier days. When a man alone in the woods sat by his fire and nothing but his buckskins and listened to a sound like that. Imagine the loneliness, the immense darkness pressing in. How frightening it must have been.
I imagine if one lacked faith in God's protection, it would be frightening.
I hear that Sister Veronica had an accident.
She fell on a piece of wood and nearly killed herself.
Is she all right?
She's fine.
Her eyesight isn't very good, is it?
Her eyesight's fine. Nuns fall, you know. It's the habit. It catches us up more often than not. What with our being in black and white and so prone to falling, we're more like dominoes than anything else.
Am I past the time?
Not at all. Sister Alicia and I were just having a nice chat.
Good morning, Father. Good morning, Sister. I'm sorry I was delayed. Mr. McKinnon closed the courtyard to fix something, so I had to go back through the convent and out the side door. And then I ran into Sister Veronica.
Oh, how is she?
She has a bit of a bloody nose.
I'm beginning to think you're punching people.
Excuse me, Sister.
Well, with the... Never mind. Sit down. I have a hot pot of tea and close this, but not quite warm steak. Would you have a cup of tea, Father?
I would love
perhaps
a cup of tea.
Perhaps you could serve him, Sister.
Of course.
And yourself, of course.
Would you like tea, Sister?
I already had my cup for today.
Is there sugar?
Sugar? Yes. I put it in one of these drawers last year for Lent and never remembered to take it out.
Must have been much to give up then.
No. I'm sure you're right. And I will serve you, though for want of practice I am clumsy. Your nails.
I wear them a little long. Sugar?
One?
Three.
Three?
Sweet tooth.
One? Two? Three. Sister, do you take any sugar?
Never. Not that there's anything wrong with sugar.
Well, thank you, Father Flynn, for making time for us. We're at our wit's end.
I think that it is an excellent idea to rethink the Christmas pageant. Last year, its effort was a little overdone.
No, I loved it. But then again, I love all Christmas pageants. I just love the Nativity, the birth of the Savior. Oh, and the hymns, of course. O little town of Bethlehem, O come, O come.
Thank you, Sister James. Sister James will be co-directing the pageant this year with Mrs. Shields. So, Father Flynn, what do you think? Is there something new we could do?
Well, we all love the Christmas hymns, but I thought that it might be jolly to include a secular song.
Secular?
It's beginning to look a lot like Christmas, something like that.
What would be the point of including a secular song?
Fun.
Or Frosty the Snowman.
There's a good one. We have one of the boys dress up like a snowman and have him dance around.
Which boy?
We do tryouts.
Frosty the Snowman espouses a pagan belief in magic. A snowman comes to life when an enchanted hat is put on his head. If the music were more somber, people would realize the images are disturbing and the song heretical. It should be banned from the airwaves.
No, Frosty.
No. It's beginning to look a lot like Christmas would be fine. I suppose the parents would like it. What are you writing there with your ballpoint pen?
Oh, nothing. Just an idea I had for a sermon.
You had one just now.
I get them all the time.
How fortunate.
I forget them, so I write them down.
What's the idea?
Intolerance. I believe that the message of the Second Ecumenical Council was that the church should take on a more familiar face. We should reflect the local community. We should play a song from the radio now and then. Maybe take the kids out for ice cream.
Ice cream.
Maybe the boys on a camping trip. We should be friendlier. The children and the parents should see us as members of their families rather than emissaries from Rome. I think that the pageant should be charming, like the local community theater putting on a show.
But we're not members of their family. We're different.
Because of our vows.
Precisely.
I don't think that we are so different.
And the people of this, the working class people of this parish expect us to be different.
I think that we are getting off subject.
Yes, you're right. Back to it. The Christmas pageant. We must be careful how Donald Mueller is used in the pageant.
Careful there, sister. You don't spill.
Yes, Father.
What is that about Donald Mueller?
We must be careful in the pageant that we neither hide Donald Mueller, nor put him forward.
Because of the color of his skin.
That's right.
Why?
Come now, Father, you're being disingenuous.
I think that he should be treated like every other boy.
You yourself singled him out for special attention. You held a private meeting with him at the rectory a week ago?
Yes.
What are we talking about?
Donald Mueller?
The boy acted strangely when he returned to class.
He did.
When he returned from the rectory, a little odd, yes.
Can you tell us why?
How did he act strangely?
Well, I'm not sure how to explain it. He laid his head on the desk and he...
You mean you had a depression?
Yes.
And he had come from the rectory, so you're asking me if I know anything about it.
That's it.
Did you wish to talk about the Christmas pageant? Is that why I'm here? Or is this what you wish to discuss?
This.
Well, I feel a little uncomfortable.
Why?
Why do you think? Something in your tone.
I would prefer a discussion of fact. Rather than tone, Father Flynn.
Well, sister, if I had judged my conversation with Donald Miller to be of concern to you, then I would have sat you down and talked with you about it. But I did not judge it to be of concern.
Perhaps you're mistaken in your understanding of what concerns me, Father. The boy is in my school, and his well-being is my responsibility.
His well-being is not an issue.
I'm not satisfied that that is true. He was upset when he returned to class.
Did he say something?
No. What happened in the rectory?
Happened. Nothing happened. I had a talk with the boy.
About what?
It was a private matter.
He's 12 years old. What can be private?
Once again, sister, I object to your tone.
This isn't about my tone or your tone, Father. But this is about arriving at the truth.
Truth of what?
You know what I'm talking about, don't you? You're controlling the expression on your face right now, aren't you?
My face? You said that you wish to talk about the Christmas pageant. That is why I'm here. Am I to understand that you brought me into your office to confront me in some way? That is outrageous. I am not answerable to you. What exactly are you?
I'm not accusing you of anything. I'm asking you to tell me what happened in the rectory.
I do not wish to continue this conversation any further. If you are dissatisfied with that, I suggest you speak to Monsignor Benedict. I can only assume that this unfortunate behavior this morning is the result of overwork. Perhaps you should take a leave of absence. I may suggest it.
Good morning, Father.
There was alcohol on his breath when he returned from his meeting with you.
Alcohol?
I did smell it on his breath.
Well?
Can you leave this alone?
No.
Very well. I see that there is no way out of this.
Take your time, Father. Would you like more tea?
Should have left it alone.
Not possible.
Donald Mueller was serving as altar boy last Tuesday morning. After Mass, Mr. McGinn caught him in the sacristy drinking altar wine. When I found out, I sent for him. There were tears, and he asked not to be removed from the altar boys. I took pity on him. I told him that if no one else found out, that I would let him stay on.
Well, look, sister, this explains everything. It's all a mistake.
And if I talk to Mr. McGinn?
Talk to Mr. McGinn by all means. Now that the boy's secret is out, I will have no choice but to remove him from the altar boys, which I think is too bad. It's what I was trying to avoid.
You were trying to protect the boy.
Right.
I might have done the same thing. Is there a way Donald could stay on the altar boys?
No. If the boy drank altar wine, he cannot continue as an altar boy.
Of course, you are right. I'm just not the disciplinarian that you are, sister. He's the only Negro at the school. It did affect my thinking on the matter. It will be commented on that he's no longer serving at Mass. It's a public thing. Certain ignorant element in the parish will be confirmed in its beliefs.
He must be held to the same standard as the others.
Of course. Did you wish to talk about the Christmas pageant?
Or... No, this was it.
Are you satisfied?
Yes.
Then I best be going. I have some writing to do.
Intolerance.
That is right. I am not pleased with how you handled this, sister. The next time that you are troubled with dark ideas, I suggest you speak to them on scene.
Look, sister, he explained everything.
You believe him?
Yes.
Isn't it that it's easier to believe him?
But we can corroborate his story with Mr. McGinn.
Oh, yes. These people are clever. Not so easily undone.
Well, I'm convinced.
You're not. You just want things to be resolved so you can have simplicity back.
I want no further part of this.
I'll bring him down with or without your help.
How can you be so sure he's lying?
Experience.
You just don't like him. You don't like it that he uses a ballpoint pen. You don't like it that he takes 3 lumps of sugar in his tea. You don't like it that he likes Frosty the Snowman, and you're letting that convince you of something terrible, just terrible. Well, I like Frosty the Snowman, and I think it would be nice if this school weren't run like a prison. And I think that it's a good thing that I love to teach history, and that I might inspire my students to love it too. And if you judge that to mean I'm not fit to be a teacher, then so be it.
Sit down. In ancient Sparta, important matters were decided upon by who shouted loudest. Fortunately, we're not in ancient Sparta. Now, do you honestly find the students to be treated like inmates?
No, I don't. Actually, by and large, they seem fairly happy, but they're all uniformly terrified of you.
Yes! That's how it works. Now sit there. Hello, this is Sister Aloysius Bovier at St. Nicholas School. Is this Mrs. Mueller? I'm calling about your son, Donald. I would like you and your husband to come down for a talk. When would be convenient?
Gossiping with a friend about a man she hardly knew. I know that none of you have ever done this. At night she had a dream. A great hand, a peered over her and pointed down at her. Immediately, she was overcome with an overwhelming sense of guilt. The next day, she went to confession. She got the old parish priest, Father O'Rourke, and told him the whole thing. "Is gossiping a sin?" she asked. "Was that the hand of the Almighty pointing down at me? Should I be asking your absolution? Father, tell me, have I done wrong?" "Yes," he replied. "Yes, you ignorant, badly brought up female. You have borne false witness against your neighbor, and have played fast and loose with his reputation, and should be heartily ashamed." So she said that she was sorry and asked for forgiveness. "Not so fast," replied the priest. "First, I want you to go home and take a pillow up to the roof and cut it open with a knife and return here to me." So she went home and took a knife from a drawer, a pillow from her bed, went up the fire escape to the roof. There she cut open the pillow with the knife and returned to the priest as instructed. "Well, did you do as I said? Did you gut the pillow with a knife?" "Yes," she replied. "And what was the result?" "Feathers, Father." "Feathers? Feathers everywhere. Now, I want you to go home and collect every feather that flew out into the wind." "Well, that cannot be done, Father. The wind took them everywhere. I don't know where they all went." "And that," said Father O'Rourke, "is gossip. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen."
I can't sleep on occasion.
No? Do you see that big hand pointing a finger at you?
Yes. Sometimes.
Was your sermon directed at anyone in particular?
Who do you think?
Did you make up that story about the pillow?
Yes. You make up little stories in order to illustrate. In the tradition of the parable.
But aren't the things that actually happen in life more worthy of interpretation than a made-up story?
No. What happens in life is beyond interpretation. The truth makes for a bad sermon. It tends to be confusing. I have no clear conclusion.
I received a letter from my brother in Maryland yesterday. He's very sick.
Perhaps you should go and visit him.
I can't leave my class.
How is Donald Mueller doing?
I don't know.
You don't see him?
I see him every day. I just don't know how he's doing. I don't know how to judge these things. Now.
actually stopped speaking to Donald for fear of it being misunderstood. Isn't that a shame? Actually avoided him when I might have crossed him in the hall. He doesn't understand why. I noticed that you didn't come to me for confession.
No. I went to Monsignor Benedict. He's very kind.
I wasn't?
It's not that, as you know. You know why?
You're against me.
No.
You're not convinced?
It's not me that needs to be convinced one way or the other. It's Sister Aloysius.
You just an extension of her?
She's my superior.
What about you?
I wish I knew nothing, whatever about it. I wish the idea had never entered my mind.
How did it enter your mind?
Sister Aloysius?
I feel as if my reputation has been damaged through no fault of my own. And I am reluctant to take the steps necessary to repair it for fear of doing further harm. It's frustrating, I can tell you that.
Is it true?
What?
You know what I'm asking.
No, it isn't true.
I don't know what to believe.
How can you take sides against me?
It doesn't matter.
It does matter. I have done nothing. There is no substance to any of this. The most innocent actions can appear sinister to the poisoned mind. I had to throw that poor boy off the altar. He's devastated. The only reason I haven't gone to the Monsignor is that I don't want to tear apart this school. Sister Aloysius would certainly lose her position as principal if I made her accusations known, since they are baseless. You might lose your place as well.
Are you threatening me?
What do you take me for? No.
I want to believe you.
Then do. Simple as that.
It's not me that needs to be convinced.
I don't have to prove anything to her.
She's determined.
To what?
Protect the boy.
It is me that cares for that boy, not her. Has she ever reached out a hand to that child or any child at this school? She's like a block of ice. Children need warmth, kindness, understanding. What does she give them? Rules. That black boy needs a helping hand, or he is not going to make it at this school. Why do you think he was in the sacristy drinking wine that day? He is in trouble. She sees me reach out to these children in a human way and immediately assumes that there must be something wrong with it. Something dirty. Well, I'm not going to let her hold this parish in the dark ages. And I'm not going to let her destroy my spirit of compassion.
Sure,
I care about this church.
I know you do.
Like you. About your students. You love them, don't you?
Yes.
It's natural. How else would you relate to children? I look at your face, and I know your philosophy. It's kindness.
I don't know. I mean, of course.
What is Sister Aloysius' philosophy, do you suppose?
I don't have to suppose. She's told me. She discourages warmth. She suggested I be more formal.
There are people, though, I will go after your humanity, Sister James, that will tell you that the light in your heart is a weakness, that your soft feelings betray you. I do not believe that. That
is an old tactic of cruel people to kill kindness in the name of virtue. Don't believe it. There is nothing wrong with love. Have you forgotten that that was the message of our Savior to us all? Love. Not suspicion, disapproval, and judgment. Love of people. Have you found Sister Aloysius to be a positive inspiration?
I don't want to misspeak. But no. She's taken away my joy of teaching. And I loved teaching more than anything.
It's all right. It's going to be all right.
I feel as if everything is upside down.
It isn't, though. There are just times in our life when we feel lost. You're not alone with them. It happens to many of us.
A bond. I'd better go in.
I'm sorry. But your brother's ill.
Thank you, Connor. I don't believe it.
Don't.
No.
Thank you, Sister James. That means a lot to me. Thank you very much. Oh, be quiet!
He looks up to him. The man gives the boy his time, which is what the boy needs.
Who needs that, Mrs. Mueller? I think we have a problem.
Well, I thought it must have been something you asking me to come in. Principal's a big job. If you stop your day just to talk to me, it must be something. I just want to say, though, it's just till June.
Excuse me?
Whatever the problem is, Donald just has to make it here till June, and then he's off into high school.
Right.
If Donald can graduate from here, then that would mean a better chance of him getting into a good high school and then an opportunity for college. I believe he has the intelligence and he wants it, too.
I don't see anything at this time standing in his way of graduating with his class.
And that's all I care about. Anything else is fine with me.
I doubt that.
Try me.
I'm concerned about the relationship between Father Flynn and your son.
You don't say. Concerned. What do you mean concerned?
That it may not be right.
Well, there's something wrong with everybody, isn't that so? You gotta be forgiven.
I'm concerned, to be frank, that Father Flynn may have made advances on your son.
May have made.
I can't be certain.
No evidence?
No.
Well, then, maybe there's nothing to it.
I think there is something to it.
Well, I would prefer not to see it that way if you don't mind.
I can understand that this is hard to hear, but I think that Father Flynn gave your son that wine to drink.
And why would he do that?
Has he been acting strangely?
No.
Nothing out of the ordinary?
He's been himself.
All right.
Look, sister, I don't want any trouble and I feel as though you're in the march somehow.
I don't think you completely understand.
I think I understand the kind of thing you're talking about, but I don't want to get into it.
What's that?
Not to be disagreeing with you, but if there's something floating around between this priest and my son, it ain't my son's fault. He is just a boy. He's 12 years old. If somebody should be going for anything, it should be the man, not the boy.
I agree with you.
You're agreeing with me, but I'm in here in the principal's office talking about my son. Why isn't the priest in the principal's office, if you know what I'm saying? Well, excuse my bringing it up.
You're here because I'm concerned about Donald's welfare.
And you think I'm not?
No, of course you are.
Let me ask you something. You honestly think that priest gave Donald that wine to drink?
Yes, I do.
Then why did my son get kicked off the altar boys? It was the man that gave it to him.
The boy got caught. The man didn't.
Then why didn't the priest get kicked off the priesthood?
He's a grown man, educated. And he knows what's at stake. It's not so easy to pin someone like that down.
So you give my son the whole blame? No problem. My son getting blamed and punished. That's easy.
Let me talk.
You know why it is. That's because that's the way it is. But you're just finding out about it. But that's the way it is and the way it's been, sister. You're not going against no man in a robe and wind. He's got the position.
And he's got your son.
So let him have him then.
What?
Just till June.
Do you know what you're saying?
No more bother than you.
I believe that this man is creating or has already created an improper relationship with your son.
I don't know.
I know I'm right.
But why do you gotta know something like that for sure when you don't? Please, sister. If you've got some kind of righteous cause going on with this priest tonight, you wanna drag my boy into it. My son doesn't need additional difficulties. Let him take the good and leave the rest when he leaves his place in June. He knows how to do that. I taught him how to do that.
What kind of mother are you?
Excuse me. But you don't know enough about life to be saying
something
like that. Oh,
I know enough.
You know the rules, maybe, but that don't cover it.
I know what I won't accept.
You accept what you got to accept when you work with it. That's the truth that I know. I'm sorry to be so sharp, but you're in here, in this room.
This man is in my school.
Well, it's gotta be somewhere. And maybe he's doing some good. Did you ever think of
that? He's after the boys.
Well, maybe some of the boys want to get caught. Maybe what you don't know, maybe is that my son is that way. That's why his father beat him up, not the wine. He beat Donald for being what he is.
What are you telling me?
I'm his mother. I'm talking about his nature now, not anything that he's done. You can't hold a child responsible for what God gave him to be.
Listen to me with care, Mrs. Mueller. I am only interested in actions. It's hopeless to discuss a child's possible inclination. I'm finding it difficult enough to address a man's deeds. This isn't about what the boy may be, but what the man is. This is about the man.
But there's the boy's nature.
Let's leave that out.
Well, then forget it then. You're the one forcing people to say things out loud. Things are in the air and you leave them alone if you can. That's what I know. They were going to kill my boy at that public school. And so, we were lucky enough to get him in here this one last year. Good. His father don't like him. He comes here and the kids don't like him. Then there's one man that's good to him. This priest. Does the man have his reasons? Yes. Everybody has their reasons. You have your reasons. But do I ask the man why he's good to my son? No. I don't care why. My son needs some man to care about him and see him through to where he wants to go, and I thank God that this educated man with some kindness in him wants to do just
this
that.
This will not do.
It's just till June. Some things aren't black and white.
And sometimes they are. I'll throw your son out of this school, make no mistake.
But why would you do that if nothing started with it?
Because I will stop this whatever way I can.
Well, throw the priest out then.
I'm trying to do just that.
What do you want from me?
Nothing. As it turns out, I thought you might know something that would help me, but it appears you don't.
Please leave my son out of this. My husband would kill that child over a thing like this.
I'll try.
I don't know, sister. You think you're doing good, but the world's a hard place. And I don't know that you and me are on the same side. I will be standing with my son and those who are good with my son. It'd be nice to see you there. It'd be nice talking with you, sister. And good morning.
May I come in?
We were having a chat.
About what?
A third party would truly be required, Father.
No, sister. No third party. You and me are due for a talk. You have to stop this campaign against me.
You can stop it at any time.
How?
Confess and resign.
You are attempting to destroy my reputation, but the result of all this will be your removal, not mine.
What are you doing in this school?
I am trying to do good.
Or even more to the point, what are you doing in the priesthood?
You are single-handedly holding this school and this parish back.
From what?
Progressive education and a welcoming church.
You cannot distract me, Father Flynn. This isn't about my behavior, it's about yours.
It's about your unfounded suspicions.
That's right, I have suspicions.
You know what I haven't understood through all of this? Why? Why do you suspect me? What have I done?
You gave that boy wine to drink, and you let him take the blame for it.
It's completely untrue. Did you talk with Mr. McGinn?
All Mr. McGinn knows is the boy drank wine. He doesn't know how he came to drink it.
And did his mother have something to add to that?
No.
So that's it. There's nothing there.
I'm not satisfied.
If you were not satisfied, ask the boy then.
He'd protect you.
And why would he do that?
Because you have seduced him.
You are insane! Have it in your head that I have corrupted this child. After giving him wine, there is nothing I can say that can change that.
That's right.
Correct me if I'm wrong. This has nothing to do with the wine, not really. You had a fundamental mistrust of me before this incident. It was you that warned Sister James to be on the lookout, wasn't it?
That's true.
So you admit it?
Certainly.
Why?
Because I know people.
That's not good enough.
It won't have to be.
How's that?
You will tell me what you've done.
Oh, I will.
Yes.
And not one of your truant boys. Sister James is convinced that I am innocent!
So you talked to Sister James? Well, of course you talked to Sister James.
Did you know that Donald's father beats him?
Yes.
And might that not account for the odd behavior observed in the boy?
Yeah, might.
Then what? What is it? What did you hear? What did you see that convinced you so thoroughly?
What does it matter?
I want to know.
On the first day of school, I saw you touch William London's wrist, and I saw him pull away.
That is all?
That was all.
That is nothing!
What are you writing now?
You leave me no choice. I'm writing down what you say. I tend to get too flustered to remember the details of an upsetting conversation, and this may be important when I tell the Monsignor why you have to be removed as principal of this school.
This morning, before my chat with Mrs. Mueller, I took the precaution of calling the last parish to which you were assigned.
What did he say?
Who?
The pastor.
I didn't speak to a pastor, I spoke to a nun.
You should have spoken to a pastor.
I spoke to a nun.
The church is very clear. You are supposed to go through a pastor.
Why? Do you have an understanding, you and he? Father Flynn, you have a history.
You have no right
this
to go wrong with Jesus.
This is your third parish in 5 years.
Call your pastor and ask him why I left.
Not calling the pastor.
I am a good priest! And there is nothing in my record suggest otherwise.
You will go after another child and another until you're stopped.
Who did you speak to?
I won't say.
Not touched a child.
You have.
Not the slightest proof of anything.
But I have my certainty, and armed with that, I will go to your last parish and the one before that if necessary, Father Flynn. I will find a parent, one who probably doesn't know that you are still working with children. And when I do, you will be exposed. You may even be attacked, metaphorically or otherwise.
You have no right to act on your own. You are a member of a religious order. You have taken vows, obedience being one. You are answerable to us. You have no right, no right to step outside of the church.
I will. Step outside the church, though the door shut behind me, Father Flynn. I will do what needs to be done, though I am damned to hell, and you should understand that, or you will mistake me. Now, did you give Donald Mueller wine to drink?
Have you never done anything wrong?
I have.
Mortal sin.
Yes.
And?
I confessed it! Did you give Donald Mueller wine to drink?
Whatever I have done, I have left in the healing hands of my confessor, as have you. We are the same.
We are not the same. A dog that bites is a dog that bites. I do not justify what I do wrong and go on. I confess, desist, and take my medicine. Did you give Donald Mueller wine to drink? Mental reservation?
No.
You lie. Very well. If you will not leave my office, I will. And when I go, I will not stop.
Wait. Do what? For the love of God, my place is here.
Don't.
Please! Are we people? Am I a person, flesh and blood like you? Are we just ideas and convictions? I can't say everything. Do you understand? There are things I cannot say. Even if you cannot imagine the explanation, sister, understand that there are circumstances beyond your knowledge. Even if you feel certainty, that is an emotion and not a fact. Of charity, I appeal to you on behalf of my life's work. You must behave responsibly. I put myself in your hands.
I don't want you.
My reputation is at stake.
You can preserve your reputation.
If you say these things, I will not be able to do my work in the community.
Your work in the community should be discontinued.
You leave me with nothing.
That's not true. It was Donald Mueller who had nothing, and you took full advantage of that.
Nothing wrong. I care about that child very much.
Why? Because you smile at him and sympathize with him and talk with him as if you were the same?
Needed a friend.
You're a cheat. That warm feeling that you experienced when that child looked at you with trust was not the sensation of virtue. It can be gotten by a drunkard from his tata room. You're a disgrace to the collar. And the only reason why you haven't been thrown out of the church is because of a decline in vocations.
I can fight you.
You will lose.
You can't know that.
I know.
Where is your compassion?
Nowhere that you can get at it. Stay here. Compose yourself. Use the phone if you like. Good day to you, Father Quinn. I have no sympathy for you. I know that you are invulnerable to true regret. And cut your nails!
Father Brendan Flynn of St. Nicholas Parish. I need to make an appointment to see the bishop.
How's your brother?
Better, much better.
Good. I prayed for him.
It was good to get away. I needed to see my family. It had been too long.
Then I'm glad you went.
And Father Flynn is gone?
Yes.
Where?
St. Jerome's.
So you did it. You got him out.
Yes.
I imagine Donald Mueller's heartbroken when he's gone.
Can't be helped. It's just till June.
I don't think Father Flynn did anything wrong.
No? He convinced you?
Yes, he did. Did you ever prove it?
What?
That he interfered
did
with
I ever?
Donald Mueller.
Did I ever prove it to whom?
Anyone but yourself.
No.
But you're sure?
Yes.
I wish I could be like you.
Why?
Because I can't sleep at night anymore. Everything seems so uncertain to me.
Maybe maybe we're not supposed to sleep so well. They made Father Flynn pastor of St. Jerome's.
Who?
The bishop. Appointed Father Flynn pastor of St. Jerome's church and school. It's a promotion.
You didn't tell them?
I told our good Monsignor Benedict. I crossed the garden and I told him. He didn't believe it to be true.
Then why did Father Flynn leave? What did you say to make him go?
That I had called a nun at his previous parish. That I had found out his prior history of infringements.
So you did prove it?
I was lying. I made no such call.
You lied?
But if he had no such history, the lie wouldn't have worked. His resignation was his confession. He was what I thought he was, and now he's gone.
I can't believe you lied.
When one takes a step to address wrongdoing, one takes a step away from God. Of course there's a price.
I see. So now he's in another school.
Yes. Oh, Sister James.
What is it, Sister?
I have doubts. I have such doubts.